My name is Robert Goldman. I'm the professor of Sanskrit, or as we call it, Savarn studies here at University of California at Berkeley in the Department of South and Southeast Asian Studies. It's a great pleasure and honor. You have to do like a rock star, right? For us this evening to have with us Kancha Ilaiah Shepherd, who's visiting us. He was born in 1952 in the village of Papaiahpet, Warangal district in Telangana state. His family belonged to a sheep grazing Kurumagolla caste, which is considered one of the numerically dominated subcastes among the Telugu speakers. And this is where he has taken now the name Shepherd, I assume. The name Ilaiah came out of the caste deity, Inoli Malana. These are derived from geographical locations in the Deccan Plateau through which shepherds usually travel in quest of their fodder for sheep and goats. So from early childhood, he has a rather different trajectory than most of the speakers we see here today. He's been coming out of a very, very remote area of so-called Shudra background, which is remarkable. I'm one of the very outstanding scholars and spokespersons for underclass in India and so on. Kancha is one of the most powerful and articulate voices opposing all forms of casteism, religious discrimination, social and economic inequality in what we like to think of as the world's greatest democracy. A great voice for the Dalit Bahujan communities of India and for marginalized groups everywhere in the world. He's been highly praised and awarded, but also subject to fierce pushback and criticism by the defenders of the traditional social hierarchy. He's been labeled as treasonous, anti-national, and has been a target for the Hindu right for his endorsement of the now unpopular so-called Aryan invasion theory, as opposed to the Hindu claims about the out of India theory. Dr. Ilaiah Shepherd took an MA in political science from Osmania University in Hyderabad, and a PhD. He has been awarded with the Mahatma Jyotirao Phule Award and was a Nehru Fellow from 1994 to 1997, as well as receiving the Manyawa Kanshiram Smriti Mahanayaka Puraskar. He's the director for the Center of the Study of Social Exclusion and Inclusive Policy at Maulana Azad National Urdu University in Hyderabad, a member of the National Research Committee constituted by the Ministry of Social Justice in New Delhi, a member of the Indian Council of Social Science Research also in New Delhi. He's a former member of the National Book Trust, Ministry of Human Resources Development, Government of India. Member of the Planning Commission subcommittee to formulate an agenda for land reforms under the 11th five-year plan. He's been a member of the UGC Constitutional Committee to oversee the implementation of OBC reservations in all central and state universities throughout India. And he's a former member of the Executive Council of the Periyar Maniammai University in Tamil Nadu. He has too many publications for me to list here, but I'm sure many of you are familiar with one of his most well-known works, Why I Am Not a Hindu, a Shudra Critique of Hindu to our Philosophy, Culture, and Political Economy. It's a piece that many people have read and many of us use in our class curriculum. I certainly have it in my class on Hinduism. And he's also the author of God as Political Philosopher, Buddha's Challenge to Brahmanism, Buffalo Nationalism, a Critique of Spiritual Fascism, and numerous articles and essays on all manner of issues having to do with class, caste, and social inequality in India and elsewhere. So, without taking too much of his time and our time, I would like now to ask you all to give a very warm welcome to Dr. Kancha Ilaiah Shepherd. Who will be speaking to us this evening on the subject of caste in the age of Modi.
Thank you very much for this lecture and that great introduction. I do not know whether I really deserve such a fabulous introduction by a very well-known, equally, you know, challenged professor from this country, in my own country. At the outset, let me thank the University of California, Berkeley, Institute of South Asian Studies, who have invited me to this talk. At a time when India is at a crossroads, we do not know which direction the political, social system of India is going to take from here to. There is a kind of anxiety all over the country, except in certain sections which are of ruling class today. It is at this juncture, this major center has asked me to speak about a very significant topic. What is caste doing in Modi's era? And this era may go in any form. The constitutional democracy, whether it is sure of moving in the direction that Dr. B.R. Ambedkar, who wrote, Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru, who led the constitutional governance in the first 17 years, we are not sure. In any case, we really depend on the global awareness and the global opinion as things shape up, because even the globe is in a right-wing direction. When the whole globe is in the right-wing direction, the fears are much more at our end. So the hope is very blinking. But even then, we need to struggle, we need to study, understand. Institutions like this play a critical role. Now, what is that caste has done to this shift is a very significant question. Many thought it was just Hindutva right-wing ideology that somehow cropped up in the age of global Islamophobia and the similar usage of a conflict in that region. But actually, what played a critical role in 1914 was caste. And so far, not many serious studies have come, about this. After 1990 Mandal reservations, I'm speaking from with a view that you all know the basics, that India has several thousands of castes, but if you look at the historical Rigvedic Varna order, which continues till today, the Brahmins on the top, the Kshatriyas next, were supposed to have been born in the gods' shoulders. The Vaishyas are supposed to have born from the feet and do only business, which I described as, in fact, it is not business but social smuggling. Then the Shudras who were said to have been born at the feet and cannot go upwards to head, nor can separate from the feet. The Dalits, untouchables, are not mentioned in the Rigvedic text, but later on evolved as untouchables in a category called Chandals. So these communities got divided into thousands of fragments, but the top three, by and large, remained in the same name, pan-Indian categories. Brahmins remained Brahmins as pan-Indian category and also as community. With modernity became more and more strengthened, and with the colonial rule, they got into English education, shifting from Sanskrit, except Sanskrit is their religious spiritual language. The Kshatriyas became weak in the process, but the Vaishya community has really become massive capitalist, and more so after 1990, where the Indian feudal structure was completely dismantled by then, and the liberalization, globalization process opened. At the same time, Mandal Commission report question came in. The backward classes were demanding for reserved seats to the tune of their population. The assessment was about 50% population. But finally, they managed to get 27% reservations. Now, these backward classes, which are in the reserved category, this category does not include all Shudras. There are higher Shudras who were, small section of them were feudal landlords during the Nehruvian Indira Gandhi period. And after that, feudalism got weakened, they formed their own regional political parties, went away from Congress, and came to power in regional states, many regional states. UP Yadavs, Bihar Yadavs, in South Tamil Nadu, the DMK, Andhra Pradesh, Telugu Desham, and now in Telangana, Telangana Rashtra Samiti, all of them are Shudra rulers. In Maharashtra, Marathas, Haryana, Jats, and so on. Now, BJP was anti-reservationist ranks from the beginning. And Congress was also not very much for reservation, particularly during Rajiv Gandhi period. It did not support the Mandal. So there was grumbling relationship of the Shudras to the Congress from then on, particularly the OBCs. So the BJP started the Mandir agenda, what we call Mandal versus Kamandal. That is the Mandir, Ram Mandir building at the place of Babri Masjid, in order to divert the whole Mandal movement and the implementation of the reservation. And with that, it started weakening Congress further from the national platform, creating communal riots at different places. And of course, Gujarat communal riot in 2002, you all know. But what many did not examined so far is the rise of crony baniya capital around Gujarat and Bombay, Mumbai. About 46% of Indian industry got concentrated in one community called Baniyas. It's a very small community. Its population is not even 1%. So from rural area, grocery shop to the Ambani, Adani, and then the steel, any industry went into their hands. And by 2014, 42% of Indian capital, particularly that grown during the period of high-tech internet period, got into the hands of Brahmins. So the whole Shudra community was left with 2.5% of the Indian capital in their hands, and the rural agrarian very divided land assets. The backward classes either depended on labor or depended on the middle small farmer agrarian economy, and by and large Dalits were depending basically on agrarian labor and the reservation profits through small to marginal middle to civil service employment. So there was a small middle class among Dalits. But what happened, the English education got concentrated in the hands of Brahmins and Baniyas, total industry. And a section of Dalits through bureaucratic mobility, they could get into English education. Backward classes were completely backward in education even today. Now you can imagine, mine war is the first autobiography I just wrote last November, finished. It is in the market now, called From a Shepherd Boy to an Intellectual. That is the first Shudra autobiography in the country. A population of about 56%. So even Sardar Patel did not write, anybody did not think of writing autobiography, because what should we write? Our caste is so low, we are just dealers. So the self-esteem was poorest of the poor within their mind. Now, what happened then? BJP, through its wing called RSS, studied the shift where the Congress failed. The shift is the backward classes from 1992-2014 became a conscious voting population. The scheduled castes were seen as an vote bank for the Congress. And the Brahmins were seen as the voting bank of mainly BJP, but a section of elite were with the Congress. And during Sonia Gandhi period, these people were around Sonia Gandhi, and during Manmohan Singh period, yet another important campaign was launched by BJP, RSS, at the village level, town level, and at the state levels, is that the minorities are ruling India. Christian Sonia Gandhi and Sikh Manmohan Singh are ruling India. What happened to us? What happened to majority Hindus? So they started recruiting OBCs into BJP RSS, and slowly they worked out a strategy that by 2014, when they saw 10 years period of Manmohan Singh and Sonia Gandhi, the minority rule, and somewhere against Muslims consistent campaign has been always there, the minority rule issue was pushed into the brains of Shudras and backward class very seriously. What will happen to you? And what will happen to Hindu history? What will happen to Hindu nation? Have we come to a point where we will allow an Italian Christian, a Sikh, to rule? They were making Manmohan Singh to sit as a kid in the lap of Sonia Gandhi, and religions were written in the back. So the BCs did not understand this. Now they did not remain there. they tactfully strategized that we should project an OBC to the Prime Minister candidate. Now, if a normal Shudra OBC, if they project as Prime Minister candidate, I don't think the Brahmins and Baniyas would support it, and Baniya capital would support that election. What they did, Narendra Modi successfully managed Gujarat, and he comes from a lower Baniya family. His caste called Mod Ganchi was included in OBC list in 1998, in the state list. And he became chief minister. After he became chief minister, he saw to it that his caste is included in the central list. Now, by 2014, they realized that since Manmohan Singh and Sonia Gandhi ruled, earlier all Brahmins, P.V. Narasimha Rao was a Brahmin, so from Nehru to others, Brahmins were controlling the political realm. The Shudras, particularly OBCs, have a hunger for even symbolic power. We must project Narendra Modi as the Prime Minister. And Modi was a very vibrant, very militant, though non-English speaking, but very organized leader. And at one go, when he came into campaign, I was at that time going into English TV channels for debates. One of the, you know, this title Modi is a Baniya open title. Modi Xerox industry is there. Huge industry. There are Modis all over as big capitalists. And his name is also Modi. There was Sushil Modi. There is a person called Sushil Modi in Bihar, who is a deputy chief minister now. He comes from Baniya family. He was on the TV channel. He said, why are you opposing an OBC prime minister? You are an OBC. Did Congress give an OBC? Did communists put any OBC leader in the Politburos and central committees? So why are you supporting them? Why are you opposing us? So suddenly, this OBC factor of Narendra Modi is projected. But they would hide systematically the entire Baniya industry of Mumbai and Gujarat went on pumping money into the campaign. And they hired young workers from OBCs who are unemployed into, you know, cycle motor and some amount of money. So RSS did the groundwork, and once he went into the campaign meetings, and Congress lost the basic direction. And they asked Rahul Gandhi to campaign, but nowhere it was working. OBCs have no trust in Congress because, most unfortunately, Professor, they have not made a single OBC at least president of India. At least vice president, at least Central University vice chancellors. No, I was there in all these small positions during that period only, not now. They will not allow me to even touch any gate there. Whatever UGC or whatever ICSSR and whatever either National Book Trust, I was during that period. But the question is, the entire crony capital started getting pumped into election, and I was shocked, how could an OBC prime minister get so much publicity? And what was happening, the publicity stunt was exactly like Trump's stunt. The strategy was, in fact, he's a guru of Trump. He started the campaign. But he is a very disciplined person. He would not talk except he tweets for only his own campaign. So what he did was, he systematically addressed public meetings by attacking Muslims and by drawing OBCs into their fold and attacking Congress and Nehru family. Now, one unfortunate thing that happened was both at the Congress level and the regional party level, all parties became dynastic. BJP did not operate on the line of dynasties because it operated on the capital, market, caste structure. For example, RSS so far never put the highest, the topmost member called Sarsanchalak, any Shudra or an OBC, only Brahmins. And, you know, only once a Kshatriya happened, Sarsanchalak, but mainly Brahmins. So that wing was working from that end. This wing was working with a very deceptive manner. This is going to be an OBC Raj, OBC state. And then at one place, in Kerala, Narendra Modi went and declared that next decade will be Dalit OBC decade. So imagine people who did not have any power structure at that level started thinking, oh, our man is becoming prime minister. And they have already organized votes, they have community votes, they have party votes. Not that they have not come to power in alliance in 1999, they came. So that base is already there. Now with 6-7% shift from the neutral base, from the OBC base, which is the largest voting population, conscious. And the Congress did not understand OBC electoral bloc was being formed with a conscious attempt, but that we were deprived of the prime ministerial position or any other, even president was not given. So what happened? If you read my book, Why I'm Not a Hindu, I was arguing as against M.N. Srinivas' thesis of sanskritization. A process of Dalitization is going to happen if once these lower castes get educated. And that Dalitization is in some form was that once reservations began to be pushed into central universities, IITs, IIMs, all of them who come to America, their destination is America. Now in India, rich people's swarga is not there. Swarga is in America. The heaven is in America. So they should come and remain vegetarian here. Don't forget that. And they should bring their temples and idol gods here also. Now what future America will have with all that, I don't know. I'm not sure. But their destination is here, and they were anti-reservationists. Anti-reservationists became suddenly OBC supporters all over, including NRIs. They were dead anti-reservationists. Suddenly became OBC prime minister supporters. Shift. Now this was because this is the best channel to capture power. And once they come to power, their main agenda is completely abolish reservation. There was that internal understanding that once we come to power, we will start a debate on reservation, and that debate ultimately concludes to goes to an end that reservations are anti-merit, anti-systemic, anti-modern, therefore we have to abolish. But I have been putting a very simple solution. We don't want reservation. We want English education in government schools from LKG to 12th. Then once our children will get English education in every school from LKG to 12th, we will see how many upper castes will be there in your IITs, IIMs, and in central universities. We will completely eliminate them by sheer number. And our understanding was, with just 7th class English education, Pune gave a vision. And with one person, 3,000 years untouchable existence, living outside the villages as lepers. Ambedkar somehow entered into school and came to degree and came to Columbia and studied in London School of Economics. He could really challenge every Brahmin intellectual, including Nehru, who studied from school level in London. Nehru could not have written such constitution. His law was not very good. Gandhi could not have written at all. I mean, look at a man who came here and then started leaving all the shirt, bunny and everything and walking naked, and Ambedkar reversed the whole dress code and started wearing suit. Sardar Patel once asked me, "What, Mr. Ambedkar, you are representing untouchables who are poorest of the poor, who don't have clothes, they all live naked. Here is Gandhi who is living like them, representing them. And you are living like a European imperial colonial master." You know what Ambedkar said? "This Gandhi knows that my people lived 3,000 years without shirt on their bodies. In future 1,000 years, he wants my people to live like that, without shirt on their bodies. But I want my people must live in suit immediately after independence. They should be on par with global people. Why should our people live semi-naked and naked? What is that?" So this is the strategy. The strategy now worked in their favor. And now the system is, situation is, it in a way, Dalitization is happening at various levels. See, Brahmins are now, entire BJP is going on engaging with Israel now. And they are saying that Zionism and Hinduism is one and the same. But the simple history they don't understand. Jews got liberated from in the days of Moses from slavery. Slaves, they were all slaves. All working people. They were Gentiles. Jesus himself was a carpenter. They were shepherds. Is there a respect to shepherd in any one of the Hindu books? Professor, you tell me, you know Sanskrit? Is there a respect to me?
Sorry.
No, where? We were wretched. And there is no respect to tilling land. There is no respect to cattle rearing. And they say cow is sacred animal. And my simple question is, why not buffalo sacred animal? Which gives 70% of Indian meat. You know, the American whites did not understand the strength of buffalo and the greatness of buffalo, because they were in full racism at that. But buffalo gives our, and the most beautiful black color buffalo is the source of our children's milk today. It's not cow. Cow gives just 16% to 17% milk. Now why it is not sacred? Because it's black. So the nationalist animal, which is domesticated in the times of Harappan civilization, is now devil animal, and the white animal, which transported from Iran or somewhere along with the Aryan invasion, therefore it is white like Aryan, is a sacred animal. And we should not understand that logic. So now Ambedkar gave us that knowledge because of English. So we said, okay, you remove reservation, but we want English education. Our children, let us establish uniform schools all over the country, remove reservation in one stroke. And now they are stuck. They are stuck. And there is a division in RSS also. Yesterday, a few days back, its chief said, there must be a debate on reservations. This joint secretary, who is an OBC general secretary, said, no, so long as caste and untouchability are there, reservation will continue. That is within RSS. Now the question is, caste is now a vibrant thing, though they want to hide. And we have now started a campaign that those who produce, the Shudras are producers, the Dalits are producers, The Adivasis are producers of the food. There is no evidence of Brahmins producing food at any point of time in history. You are not created by God from the head, only to eat through head. You have to work with hands. And this transformation, ideological transformation, is not going to keep quiet. Once the idea caught. So, Dalitization is happening. But not at the level that, see, Emerson was said that once the Dalits and the OBCs and the Shudras begin to educate themselves, they'll get Brahminized and Sanskritized. But Sanskrit did not survive there. Goddess Saraswati shifted from Sanskrit to English. So what is Sanskritization that Emerson Watson is talking about? Why should universities teach that theory? I don't understand. If South Asian institutes are teaching, it is a totally dead theory. Now what is happening is, why did a Baniya take an OBC certificate? Because Baniya found earlier a scope for getting a job through that means, apart from your business. Here a Baniya took an OBC certificate that he will become Prime Minister if he claims that he is an OBC. Earlier that was insult. You should claim that you are a Kshatriya or you are a Brahmin, even if you don't know any education or anything, but you can, if you have some white color somewhere, you pass on as Brahmin yourself, because that is the survival strategy. There is a book written from New York, a girl called Yashika Dutt. She passed off as a Brahmin in Delhi University, in Times of India, and having come here as a journalist, after one boy's suicidal death, Rohit Vemula, she, out of anguish, she came out and wrote her autobiography. So those were the days. Kshatriyas. Shudras think that we are all Kshatriyas. We were all rulers. But now, one Baniya, in one way I think this is good. Modi coming as a, he realized that in UP, Bahujan Samaj and Samajwadi party, the Yadav-led party and the Dalit party got united. The only way to defeat them is take out the lower OBCs from the whole nexus. Group. He said, I am an MBC, most backward. In 2014, he was a backward class. Now in 2019, he became most backward. What is this? What is this? This is the power game. And now RSS is saying, no, we are not against reservation. They were dead against it. And they were not allowing us to read Sanskrit also. They were not allowing us to learn English. Nobody demanded English medium schools in government sector. You know, I keep telling my Catholic friends, you educated in St. Stephen, St. Joseph, St. Mary, St. Xavier, all Arunshauris, Arunjetlis. Not us. I did not learn this English. I learned this English under a tree by reading Karl Marx's Communist Manifesto. Not in your school. So, the question today for Dalit Bahujans is, it is not just theoretical, it is not academic, how to really regain power from a pretended OBC to real OBC. A real OBC who is a Shudra, who tilled the land, who looked after cattle, and then protect. They say that vegetarianism is great. They are preaching that theory here. 65% of Indian food constitutes meatarianism. I don't use the word non-vegetarian because my food need not be approached like this. It's a straight vegetarianism, beefarianism, fisharianism, we all got that. Without that, India will starve and die. What do they think? So do our soldiers eat vegetarian and fight Pakistan or China? And they say, yoga should be global. I keep saying, let these yoga pundits, Ramdev, Narendra Modi, Amit Shah go to the Chinese border, sit on the cold mountains and do yoga at least for 1 week, and then face Chinese, and they when they come with karate. And they come with beef, pork, snake, frog, every meat. See, nationalism they put upside down. Now what we are saying is, we are the original nationalists, the nation belongs to us. A nation belongs to producers, but not without producing, those who consume nation does not belong to them. There was no Brahmin regiment to defend our country at any point of time in history. There was no Baniya regiment, but there was Mahar regiment, that is Ambedkar's caste regiment. Ambedkar's father was a soldier. Was Gandhi's father soldier? Was Nehru's father soldier? Subhash Chandra Bose's father soldier? No. We were different, our people were defenders. Producers and defense. Production and defense were our duty. The nation belongs to us. We will not allow an inch to China or Pakistan. But you cannot rule us. We should rule. So that they, and maybe if it leads to a very major problem, I don't know what will happen. It is certainly not simple as they are thinking. They can take it back to the Varna Dharma time. Their theoretician called Woolworth, in a book called The Nation Would Define, said that a day should come, India should go back to the original Varna Dharma order. Not only all Indians, but the whole world should come to the feet of Brahmin. But you must decide whether you want to go to their feet or not. I have rejected Brahmin feet when I was 15, when my mother died. He took all the money, doing some puja, throwing some water upside, saying that your mother is there. Finally said, touch my feet. I said, I will not touch your feet. I will not touch your feet. Then I will not touch your school of thought at all. Since then, I never looked back. Because our head was made to surrender to their feet, and once it is surrendered, it could never recover. That is the danger. Now today we are conscious. So my mission is, Ambedkar in a way psychologically liberated Dalits. They are fighting the battles every day. But the OBCs are semi-conscious, unconscious, non-English educated. I don't know whether you have seen any one of OBCs becoming a teacher in your South Asian center here. No, I don't think. Even in Delhi, JNU, anywhere they are not there. Because we don't have English. That is the yardstick of merit. So we are hoping that OBCs will open up the whole new discourse. But we are spiritually bound by the Hindu order. Because we are born at feet. We are not going out, not going up. We are stuck. So how to liberate them? Spiritual fascism is the root of social fascism. And social fascism and spiritual fascism together will produce political fascism. And we lived in that for 3,000 years. Spiritual fascism is a very, very binding structure. It will not allow. And I keep telling, see, if Shudra communities, Reddys, Raus, Kamma, Jats, Patels, if they can't become a priest in a Hindu temple, how do they go to heaven after death? The gate is closed for you because you have no right of religion here. You have no right to become a priest here. You have to do only menial jobs around temples and visit. And so this question is fundamental. I have been asking RSS BJP, declare that if you believe that Hinduism is a religion, like, okay, Judaism you are claiming, Judaism or Christianity or any other religion, say that all Hindus can become priests. All Hindus, irrespective of caste. Then they can, But it is very difficult to make the OBCs understand this, because there is a 3,000 years of internalization of Brahmin power. If you oppose Brahmin, you are opposing God. They are Bhu Devatas. So they were gods. They are gods on land. That's how the structure is. Our women are much more internalizing, and they surrender to any Brahminic priest. That is the reason why thousands of these fellows survive. So the question today cast in Modi's era is, it has taken a new turn. And the new turn, if they realize that this is not going to be allowed, they may become very, very authoritarian. And they may even change the basic structure of the constitution. So our struggle now is to protect and defend this Ambedkar constitution. I keep telling my communist friends, stop all other things, come into elections, and let us together protect Ambedkar constitution. If this constitution works for 100 years, then we will see a real change, then gradual progress. But Muslims also committed historical blunders. They called this nation Hindustan. In all Akbar records, it is Hindustan. Consciously, Ambedkar and Nehru avoided that name in the constitution. If it is made Hindustan in the preamble of the constitution, then Hindu Raj, the Hindu state. So this is a Muslim, they ruled us 800 years. So Al-Biruni came and wrote a book called Al-Hind, describing non-Muslims as Hind, and then it went on, and they have created us a problem also. And now they are in problem and we are in problem. But my question is, yes, their Kashmir or any other thing, theirs is a different problem. Ours is a 3,000 years old. Theirs is a short period. So my appeal to all the scholars here is, please come and study the productive potential and the creative potential of Dalits, OBCs and Shudras. And give us a direction, because one scholar cannot achieve goal. Thousands of books come on this direction. This is a great center. I'm really thankful to you for inviting me and listening what I said. Thank you all. I can take questions.
Thank you very much, Kancha, for a very heartfelt and stirring presentation from your own experience. And we learned many interesting things about who is OBC and who is not OBC. We also learned something new to me, which was racism among cattle. This is a new one for me. But black and white cows, that's another problem. Anyway, I think that your talk would have stimulated a number of questions and comments, and I don't want to take up time. So let me start off the question. I think Abhishek, did you have a question?
Yeah.
Go ahead, please.
Yeah. So thank you so much. That was a really enlightening, wonderful talk. And I want to
ask. Come up and take the microphone, since they're recording this. Can you?
So thank you. That was a really enlightening talk in many ways. I want to sort of ask you to say a little bit more about the topic that you began to touch on right at the end of your talk, and that is the question of Muslims in South Asia. And I was just wondering, you know, if you look at the most recent elections, but also more broadly, why is it that there has been an inability to make an alliance between these two groups who have suffered the most under Hindutva? So what is the cause that this has actually not happened? And why does it continue to not happen, right? Why is Asaduddin Owaisi not a leader for the lower castes in Telangana and Andhra Pradesh?
Shall I answer one by one, or if there are many questions? But anyway, see, The Muslim question in India is a very complicated question. It is not just electoral question. The OBCs in urban areas have a deep antagonistic relations for quite a long time with the Muslim rulers earlier, Muslim administration earlier, because Dalits were outside the village doing the leather work, shuan and so forth, and they were in any case, whether the Muslim rule or pre-Muslim rule, they were having the same status in the villages. But the Shudra OBCs think that there was an oppression by Muslims. At a time there was no religious identity to them. This word Hindu was not there. You all know that Hinduism was applied to that Sanatan Dharma, what we call Varna Dharma religion, by Raja Ramon Rai in the late 19th century only. Since then they started owning this. So now it has gone into the mind of OBCs, yes, we have a religious identity. And these Muslims will not come with us. The other major factor is, in fact, I was asking this question. Why is it that Persian was a ruling language of India for about 300 to 400 years? Not a single book was written on caste and untouchability by any Muslim scholar. And Urdu is a national language, not a single book. And if you see, when Ambedkar was fighting the battle of caste along with Jinnah, see, Jinnah was a Baniya convert. And their famous poet who gave the theoretical direction to Muslims was Allama Iqbal. Iqbal was a Brahmin Kashmiri Pandit convert. So the lower castes went into Islam but remained at the lowest of the low without any identity, without any strength. So what happened when this Hindu RSS was formed? In urban areas, OBCs flocked around it and they organized. Not to promote them in education. They admitted them in what is known as Hanuman Vyayam Shalas. The exercise Vyayam Shalas. And their muscle power was big. The Brahmin children were sent into medicine, engineering, IIT, IIM. The Shudra children, OBC children were recruited into muscle power squads. But there was that pride of religion. So therefore, it was not easy to... Secondly, these Muslim parties are not parties. Even OBC's party is a small single party. Just wins one MP seat. Then in Kashmir, there are two Muslim parties. Both of them are family parties. National Conference and that
PDP.
Mama Said's
PDP.
PDP. So, see, party cannot be like this. So, the hope was Bahujan Samaj. We thought that the OBCs will align with Bahujan Samaj. But RSS systematically created a rift between OBCs and then Mulayam Singh and these Shudra upper layers started their own regional parties, they came to power. And now, the crisis is that if once reservation is removed, OBCs will remain. OBCs will have come, they have come to a state, at least a small intellectual. See, remember, intellectuals are important for leadership. Visioned intellectuals, not local level political rule or feudal rule. Among Shudras, there are no such intellectuals. And we could not even communicate with Muslim leadership. They were English educated, Oxford educated, Cambridge educated. We were at the local language level. See, I think over a period of time, in my view, Muslims have to reform a lot. And we will have to think different. But that depends on the mutual understanding that develops over a period of time. For example, triple threat. OBC women don't like it. Today we don't like any husband leaving, telling three words and going out. They don't know much about religion. They don't know about Quran. But they don't like this kind of a thing. Our OBC, in why I'm not a Hindu, I said, we live in Dalit Bahujan democratic patriarchy. If husband beats, our women beat husbands also. If husband drinks, our women drink also. If husband smokes, they smoke. So we are not living in Brahminic patriarchy. Muslim patriarchy is not acceptable to them. These are the problems. So we need to overcome them from both sides.
Question over here. When do you decide caste discrimination is getting over in India?
Ending over in
India? Yeah, like, when is it reducing? What are like the obvious signs for that?
Well, see, theoretically, Ambedkar wrote annihilation of caste. And Yash extensively studied and said, unless Hinduism is dismantled, caste cannot be dismantled. Caste cannot be dismantled, untouchability cannot be dismantled. See, he looked at the layers of it. And then there were technical solutions, inter-caste marriage is one, inter-dining is one, so on and so forth. My basic thesis is, caste survives with indignity of labor. The shoemakers, the pot makers who made the early leather industry were completely put as untouchables. The agrarian community, cattle rearers, shepherds, pot makers or smiths, all kinds of artisanal professions were pushed into Shudra layer. Now, we need to bring them to the parallel lane first. And then this whole problem of vegetarianism and food culture, man-woman relationships culture, in these things, caste will not disappear. Caste can be brought to the level of respecting each other to the same thing. And Hinduism issue is resolved, is related to the priesthood question. If the Shudras become priests, see, Hinduism also is unreformed religion. Our priests don't wear shirts. Never. They come to marriage where everybody wore a lot of good clothes, they come swimming. So, and then they recite mantra, neither the bride and bridegroom understand it, but they will, with aeroplane speed they will recite. And whether he is asking them to marry, live together, die tomorrow, produce children, not produce, nothing is known. But only two things are known. Samarpayami, give away, give all that, swaha. See, this, even this appeals to them. They will invite them. I keep telling them, you are not understanding anything. Why are you inviting? No. God is there. He is telling God. What is he telling? You don't know. It is like our lawyers, what they are telling in English to the judges when their illiterate parent, clients are, that is our situation. And we need to change this over a period of time.
Actually,
I want to go back to your discussion about Ambedkar. So there was a short period in which Ambedkar was also looking at the Black Panther movement and Du Bois, and at a somewhat later stage there is some exchange of letters between Ambedkar and Du Bois. And several years down the line there was the Dalit Panther. So what happened to that,
Ilaiah? What happened is that even now, the question of caste becoming an international issue is a major problem. I was one of the team members when we took it to Durban conference in 2001, but no nation was willing to listen to us. Whereas the race question became internationalized, not at Du Bois time or Martin Luther time, but at the time of Abraham Lincoln. So you must understand the history. Abraham Lincoln, while being a white, he took the side of blacks, and the world did not know, so far, whether the French Revolution, British Revolution, any revolution, was not such radically shifting positions from a ruling position. So black question, slave question, Negro question became internationalized from then on to, then Dubai came, then Martin Luther King came. But in our case, see, in 2007, we went to Los Angeles, myself, a friend of mine. We wanted to request directors, producers, some actors we met. We wanted a Hollywood film on caste and ethnicity, so that it can be communicated to the West. That is the best medium. Then we met several people. One of them sponsored off day workshop. They were very top directors, luckily they came. They said, we can't understand this, how this functions. How Indians here look the same. What caste they may be, they look the same. How do they practice untouchability? And see, the race, you can easily understand. Slavery, you can easily understand. Man-woman inequality, you can understand. How do you understand the same color man treating another man as untouchable? So then they suggested there should be a good novel on it. Then we can extract something from that and make a film. And very novel like, leave alone novel, we can't write essay. After Ambedkar, we are struggling to write something. Where is novel writers? We requested some white people to come and write. No, now they don't come and write for us. Some of them from France are going for BJP to write. The full time. So there are money there. What is there with us? It needs a commitment. Now there is an opening up. Yesterday I was in Stanford University, the South Asia Center director was saying, you know, caste problem is a better serious concern today to the West than even an issue like Kashmir. I was a bit happy with that, you know. They are understanding caste. But I think more and more work needs to be done. And some among you, see, we can't write novels. We are not trained to write books at all. We are trained to train cattle, till the land, you know, eat goat food very well, but not sophistication writing. Some of you should write a novel for us on untouchability. And then see that a film is produced. Once a Hollywood film comes, something comes up. See, it's a very difficult process. In all, Shudra Dalits put together are 900 million people. No spiritual equal rights. Religion is the ruling structure of the world. But we don't have spiritual rights. In the same religion where we say, is Judaism functioning like that? Can any Israelite, Jewish person, can anybody not remain without becoming a rabbi there? No, anybody can become a rabbi. But this is not a... So I keep asking my Brahmin friends, if you are so great, you discovered everything, why did you not discover a simple thing of abolition of caste? And where are your scientists? You leave alone Einstein. Did you produce a single? Some of our people are coming here, collaborating with Westerners and getting some so-called Nobel Prize. Without that collaboration, it won't come. And here only, they should live here. My question is, live in India. You know, don't make us... In fact, I gave a slogan in JNU the other day. If nationalism is true, we should say only Indian PhDs will get recruited into Indian universities. No foreign PhD. You may be disappointed, some of you. But what is their nationalism? The same BJP imports foreign scholars, their economists are from Colombia. Why should this happen? Don't we have brains? Don't we have self-respect? So this is a problem. Caste is not seen, not understood, not perceived. At least they have not shown interest. That is the problem.
We have time for two questions in back there.
Can we start? could you explain what your view is on the Communist Party in India, and or do they have a role in the future, or because they don't have sort of a spiritual narrative, will they fail to capture the Dalit and OBC votes in upcoming elections?
No, in fact, this is one of major problems we are confronting there. Communist parties remained theoretically and practically caste blind till 1990. Even they were in 1990. I was a young lecturer, and I was with civil rights movement by then. When we said reservation must be supported, they all opposed. So we had to come out of those structures and fight the battle, because we saw a hope in reservation. I myself got my lecturership in the state level reservation, but they were not recognized. Now the other problem is, Bengal was ruled by communists for 34 years. And in Bengal, the simple data says 25%, 25-26 are Nama Sudras, that is the Dalits. About 34-35 could be easily OBCs. Not a single person from those communities could come to Politburo. Because what Bengal communists did is, like anybody else, private English medium school, they sent their children, and entire rural belt is left to Bengal. And without English, you can't come to Politburo. So this is a good mechanism. You don't allow us to learn in the schools, you rule. So recently I wrote two articles which angered them. One CPI put one Dalit as the general secretary. I said this is a liberation, a hope. But CPM does not want to put one person, scheduled caste, scheduled tribe in the Politburo. Without becoming Politburo, how do you become general secretary of the party? Remember? Then I was facing the bitter wrath, anger by BJP people on TV channels. Now I am not going to TV channels. They were saying, Narendra Modi in OBC, where is an OBC in Politburo of CPM? You are supporting them? I had to bend my head down. See, if this is the trend, they will completely become oblivion 20, 30 years from now. They will have to seriously, and if they don't study Hinduism seriously, they thought that when I'm writing why I'm not a Hindu, Buffalo Nationalism, post-Hindu India, I'm a fool. See, this is not the way to look at creativity, new writing. They remain completely indifferent, but we keep on telling that Ambedkar and Marx need to be put together. Caste and class are realities. And here my friend started this Martin Luther, Ambedkar Martin Luther Study Center. We are hopeful that the West will at least see through Martin Luther, who is Ambedkar and who is caste. So these kind of experiments need to be done. Left is really not in shape now.
I have one more question there, and then I'll take two after that. You can go ahead.
I just had a question regarding, we talked about regional Shudra parties, be it the Yadavs or the Marathas. Judgment, there is a pattern where it is, the power is becomes dynastic. Is that it's a pan-Indian pattern? Can you sort of talk a little bit more about why? Is that a Shudra dynamic or is it just a political dynamic?
No, the tragedy began with Indira Gandhi becoming Prime Minister. And then the dynasty cut up in Congress. And accidentally she died. And by then, the Indian feudalism, I think serious studies should take place from centers like this. Communists are saying that India is still semi-feudal, semi-colonial. In my view, it is wrong. Indian feudalism got disintegrated. Capitalism caught on. And monopoly capital got accumulated. But dynasty continued. Indira Gandhi suddenly was killed. Our son was made the ruler. And individual leaders from other side could not dare to take on the party roles. The family control increased. Now then when you start regional parties are virtually family fiefdoms. So one after the other, the sons were coming. If the son was not coming, it was collapsing because there is no ideology. Communists have been, see communists, look at communists, they are not dynasties. After Jyoti Basu, his son did not become, or any leader like that. And the right-wing BJP is not dynasty. Unfortunately, Congress, the first ruling party, unlike the European and American experiences, that became dynastic and other structures went on justified. Now BJP focuses on that issue. So newly educated youth and others really think that this is not good. Where should be our hope? Where should be our? So my feeling is that I think is part of the, but look at the Muslim countries also. Bangladesh is dynastic. Even Pakistan, Bhutto family is dynastic. There is that feudal dynastic structures involved in that. Communists could have broken that if they were to come into electoral politics like Nepal by giving up armed struggle, everything, appeal for what I call socialist welfare state, you know, social democratic welfare state, perhaps they could have, for example, communists are never caught in corruption in India, having ruled for so long. It's a great achievement. BJP is corrupt, Congress is corrupt, leaders are arrested, but they did not encash on that. They did not also see what good experiment that Nepal has done by becoming, still some Maoist groups are there, thinking that, you know, weapons can bring power there. It's not possible. So this is the problem there. Let us see what happens.
Of course, when the PM is a brahmachari, you don't have to worry about the dynasty.
Yeah, go ahead. And then I have one more after.
Professor Ilaiah, I wanted to thank you for the brilliant talk, but also for the work of your life. It has been a guiding spirit for many of us.
Thank you.
So thank you for
thank
that.
You.
And I wanted to mention Kashmir very sparingly, and especially in context to the talk yesterday at Stanford. And I think I would like to propose you do not need to fall into a brahminical ploy put these two issues in competition with each other. In fact, there are ways, including in my work, where you can think about Kashmir through the lens of Brahminical colonialism. In your work, in Baba Saheb Ambedkar's work, we have a theorization of caste as a colonial imprint of 3,000 years. And our historical work, our ethnographic work on a country that's besieged right now on genocide alert shows that there is a casteist imprint on our colonialism. Mm-hmm. Not just the way, you know, despite the caste atrocity laws in the Constitution of India, we know that de facto there is no justice for Kerlanji, for any of our Mari Champion. There has never been justice for.
Is there a question?
There is a question.
Yes, please.
But for Kashmiris, our colonialism has been casted and it's de jure. It's through AFSPA, which does not allow us to take our culprits to court. And the way we are treated, you know, no communication for today is the 39th day. Mm-hmm. And stripping naked, naked parades, blackening of faces, these come out of Manusmriti.
Yeah.
Even the laws during the Dogra rule, which have de facto turned on.
Why don't you have a personal conversation at the reception and let this be a Q&A session?
I got your point. See, just one small this thing. See, Kashmir issue, the present regime used to its systematic advantage, right, by undoing Article 370, imposing curfew and locking up the whole state. But those of us who are involved in the Dalit Bahujan liberation struggles, you know, if we go on to enter into every other issue that comes up, our focus of 900 million people will suffer. So we recognize it as a serious, recognize it as a national determination question issue. I was in Kashmir in 1992, but that we don't want to make our focus issue, because some issues drag on, and our issue is the only issue which can change the present regime. Kashmir issue cannot change the present regime. Kashmir is however they fight. We can change it. The Dalit, Bahujan, the Shudras. If the Shudras align with BCs and BCs with Dalits, we can change it. And we can understand, we can expose the Narendra Modi regime's control through various mechanisms of capital and caste. So that is our direction. We don't want to be detracted, at least myself.
I think the point you made about capital and caste speaks to one of the great sort of questions about the future of the BJP and the Sangh Parivar in general, which is that they have, now they've made their electoral gains reaching out to the OBCs, to Adivasis, and yet still their sort of economic funding infrastructure is limited to these upper caste sort of communities. And so how is it that the BJP, in your opinion, on the Sangh Parivar in general, sort of bridge this contradiction between where the current electoral success comes from and when they eventually are sort of called to task by the communities which this political movement originated in?
See, when Ambedkar was alive, there was no strong structure called RSS which he could have imagined that it would one day form a political party and that would come to power. He and Nehru were struggling to settle a state between socialism and democracy advancements. That was, the communist parties were the future direction at that time, not BJP. The Soviet Union, China, therefore they adopted a via media course of planning and democratic socialism and so on. Ambedkar thought of state socialism. He mapped up the whole state socialism. But today, by my generation, at least I wrote an article in 2002 in Hindu that Narendra Modi is likely to become Prime Minister of India. You can just Google that article, is there. Kancha Ilaiah Narendra Modi, you'll find it. The simple direction was, caste system can be really brought to a conflict of change in the dialectical relationship unless complete Hindu right wing comes to power. The secularism discourse actually misled us. We didn't understand what secularism is. I'm a Dalit, I'm an untouchable, I'm a Shudra, I cannot become a priest, but there are the Brahmins rule everywhere, and they're all calling themselves secular, not changing themselves at all. What is this secular? We have no sense of secularism. Secularism is of a systematic control of that. America could not have visualized this situation, but I knew that a day will come, BJP will come to power. And we'll have to pass through this phase. It is inevitable. Now, how they handle, the whole world is going into a religious controlled democracy. If they give equal rights, all castes are getting pushed into religious equality, spiritual equality, and right to religion, anti-conversion laws are reduced or whatever, or put culture issues are resolved, then they may remain for longer time in power. Congress remained for 52, almost 70 years in one form or the other. They may be there for 30 years, 40 years, we don't know. But meanwhile, there will be a shake-up. So we are hoping a campaign of English education for all, at least from LKG to 12. Our children from one end of Kanyakumari to Kashmir, to this end, to that end, must speak one language, that is English. then, you know, any book we write will be read, a discourse will start, a new vision thought will rise, and even the right-wing politics need to be tackled at that level. I don't know when a situation comes in what form, or it can break out into a very violent situation. I don't know. If the religious issue becomes more and more stressful, one of my books is, my next book is being considered for publication. It's called Clash of Cultures in India. Like clash of civilizations, what you are talking, we have deeper clash of cultures. Where does it lead? I really don't know. Thank you very much.